to God. To you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first epistle of John. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning, because he has been born of God. By this it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the Good Shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. The Gospel of the Lord.
Pray. Lord Jesus, we want to hear your voice. We want to hear the voice of the Good Shepherd. We want to know your voice in our hearts. So we pray that our hearts would be open this morning and each day to receive your voice and to receive what you have for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Well, good morning. I am truly blessed to be with you as interim rector. And I've been enjoying this week getting to know a few, but I'm looking forward to getting to know many more. And it's going to be a real privilege for me to take this role in your church. This past week, people have been sharing with me different perspectives on what has happened and how we got to where we are now. So different stories, different narratives. I wonder what God's perspective is. I think God sees all the perspectives but doesn't take sides. God looks at our hearts. Our hearts are what God is interested in. What is going on in your heart in relation to God? What is going on in your heart in relation to others? And by the way, if you happen to be someone who is unaware that anything was going on in the church behind the scenes, that's good because you can be one of our prayer warriors who prays with holy indifference. And that means holy indifference doesn't mean that one doesn't care, but it means that one isn't invested in a particular outcome and can pray with openness for healing and wholeness for the parish. And I invite all of us to pray that way. I know one thing for certain, and that is that God is for you, and God loves each of you so much, and that God loves Christ the Redeemer, so we are safe in God's loving hands. For the next Sundays of Easter, we are in the Gospel of John, and the epistle readings are taken from 1 John. Now, both of these were written by John the Apostle, who was one of the three disciples closest to Jesus. In his gospel, John refers to himself as the beloved disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. That's his identity, the beloved disciple. John knows himself to be deeply loved by Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And in his epistle, he calls us beloved too. We are all God's beloved. John knows that as we receive God's love, we become lovers, people who don't just love a few other people, our family and friends, but we become people who live in love, who are saturated in love. Like a branch abides in a vine, like light that permeates everything. Our lives are to be inseparable from love. And so we step into this vast love of God the way one steps into an ocean. And I think of the hymn, "Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its fullness over me." This is what John the Apostle has experienced, and this is what he invites us to experience. Not just to love a little, but to live in love. The Celtic Church, like the Orthodox churches, trace their apostolic origin to the Apostle John rather than the Apostle Peter, which is interesting. In John's gospel, the beloved disciple leaned on Jesus' breast at supper, at the Last Supper. And we can imagine that he heard the heartbeat of Jesus. The Celtic Church talks about listening for the heartbeat of God. And I think John, through his gospel and his letter, invites us to draw close to Jesus, to lean into his embrace, to rest our heads against his breast and listen for the heartbeat of God. So in the next weeks, as we look at the writings of John, let's listen with him for the heartbeat of Jesus. This morning, our gospel reading is from John 10, where Jesus speaks to us about how he is our good shepherd. He's the good shepherd because he leads us to life. He loves and cares for us. He protects us. He even lays down his life for his sheep. Those who belong to the good shepherd know his voice, and they won't follow the voice of any other shepherd. They only have ears for Jesus' voice. You know, there are so many voices out there that clamor for our attention. And many of them claim to be Christian voices speaking for God. How do we discern what is really the voice of Jesus? And what are the voices of the false shepherds? The answer is that we stay close to Jesus. A very important way of doing this is to read the Gospels slowly and prayerfully, with our hearts engaged, one story at a time. We ask ourselves as we're reading, what does Jesus do in this situation? What does he say? How does Jesus respond to people? What does he think? What does he feel? What do I notice about the heart of Jesus, his compassion, his kindness? Why did Jesus do that? Why did he say that? We sit with these questions, allowing the mystery of who Jesus is, the mystery of his ways, rest in our hearts. We ask ourselves, how does what I see in Jesus' interactions with people show me what is in my own heart? Where am I with this? What do I want to say to Jesus? What do I hear Jesus saying to me? When we come to the Gospels, we want to come with humility rather than thinking that, you know, I've read this a million times and I know what it means, you know. Do we come to the scriptures with open hearts, ready to receive from God? Spending time with Jesus in this way, a little each day, helps us come to know the voice of the Good Shepherd unmistakably. His voice begins to live in us, in our hearts. In John's first epistle, he's writing for a church that is needing to discern the voice of the Good Shepherd. Some false shepherds have been trying to draw people away from what is God's truth. The false teachers are apparently denying the incarnation, a kind of early version of Gnostic ideas that became a major challenge to the early church. John is trying to help the church, or maybe a group of churches, discern what is teaching from God and what is not. Who belongs to the sheepfold and who does not? Among all the voices and claims to speak for God, these churches need to be discerning the voice of Jesus. Well, times have not changed, have they? This is the perennial challenge of the church that lives in the world. And I think the clamoring voices in our time have gotten even louder, even more strident, ever more present to us in our lives. So what does John say to help this church that he's writing to? First thing he does is he reminds them of who they are. He reminds them of the tremendous gift that God has given to us, that we are his children. We belong to him. John begins with the word look. Well, look hardly expresses the wonder John feels at this truth. He says, look at what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. It's astonishing. It's amazing. And we're not just children in name, John says. We are truly God's children now. There's a wonderful mystery in this that John is inviting us to acknowledge. We have this intimate, loving, familial relationship with the Father that changes everything. It changes how we look at everything. It gives deep, abiding peace, knowing that we're in the Father's heart and nothing can snatch us away from him. But it gets better. We're going to be like God because someday we will see him as he truly is, and our transformation into Christ comes by seeing him as he is. The contemplatives call this the gaze of love. We gaze at Jesus, who gazes at us in love. This is the heart seen with the eyes of the heart, because transformation is at heart level. That's why we can't bring about our own transformation by just trying harder. We can't see into our own depths. Only God can do that. And so, although our transformation into Christ won't be complete until we are with him in the next life, we're called to purify ourselves just as he is pure. And so we do this because we are in a loving relationship with God, because this is the whole purpose of who we are, is to be in this loving relationship with God. So it's our response to the Father's love that we want to purify ourselves. Johnny Cash wrote a song, and maybe you know it, where he says, I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. Because you're mine, I walk the line. Well, so that's it. That's love. That's what makes us want to purify ourselves. We keep a close watch on our hearts. We keep our eyes open so we don't get pulled away from this love. We want to be pure as he is pure because we're in love with God. To live in God's way in this way is what transforms us into the likeness of Christ. In a couple of weeks, we'll read in John's letter, in chapter 4, that God is love. When we abide in God's love, we become love the way God is love. Now, John's next point is that Christ and sin are incompatible. How we live matters. The false teaching that was leading people astray in John's time seems to have been saying that how you live with people doesn't matter as much as having the right ideas and having the right knowledge, that faith is a matter of the mind. But John is being very clear here that how we live in our bodies matters. He speaks of lawlessness. But John is not speaking about the Torah or the Jewish law, and he's not speaking about what we might call law and order. Nor is it mostly about outward behavior, but it's about the state of our hearts, which is always what Jesus is concerned about. The Pharisees were model Jews. They were exemplary in their keeping of the law. They were righteous and had all the answers to all the questions of the law, but they had hardened hearts. And because of this, they were deaf to Jesus' teaching. They were blind to who he was. So John is concerned about our hearts. Have we God's seed in us? He says that we have God's seed and that we have been born of God. So if we have been born of God, then our lives should bear witness to that by the way we love our brothers and sisters, he says. In John 13:34, Jesus said, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another." So this is the law of love that Christians are to live by. When we're seeking to become like Christ, to purify ourselves as he is pure, we are pained to see the ways in which we're untrue to the one who loves us, the ways we're not walking in love. We're grieved by our sin. So John is concerned about those who live in habitual sin and don't seem to be bothered by it. If we're walking in love, then we're willing to do the self-reflective work of looking with God at what's in our hearts that needs to change. When I was in my 30s, the Lord brought me onto a journey of healing from a lot of deep wounds from childhood through the healing ministry at All Saints. At one point, I became aware that I had a problem where I could not say I was sorry when I had hurt someone. It's the strangest thing, but of course, I could say sorry if I accidentally bumped into someone. I was polite. But to say I was sorry about hurting someone literally felt like I was going to die. I know that sounds like I'm exaggerating, but it really did feel that way. And I just felt blocked inside. I think it's because it was so connected to deep feelings of shame. So finally, with great fear and trepidation, I went to my priest for confession about this, and also for generational healing, because I realized that this was something that went back several generations in my family. After my confession, I didn't really notice any change for a few days, but about 3 days later, I did something that I knew I needed to admit that I was wrong and to say I was sorry. I forget what it was, but I probably said something mean to my husband. I would imagine, back at that stage of my life. I was amazed when I noticed that the horrible feeling that I was going to die if I said I was sorry was just gone. I had received the spiritual healing, and that had been broken in my life. I'd been set free from that connection with shame. And I now had a choice. I knew that I needed to act upon my new freedom so that I wouldn't slip back into that spiritual bondage. And so I did. I apologized. And from that time on, I was set free from the fear of saying I was sorry. Confession is an important way to set us free from the hold certain sins may have on our lives. By bringing sin into the light, that in itself reduces the power it has over us. Confession also helps set us free from the burden of guilt that we carry when we keep our sins hidden. They're released, and we hear the words that we are forgiven. So for me, in confession, a real spiritual bondage was broken by God. So what's in your heart? As you keep a close watch on your heart, do you notice God nudging you about something that needs to change for the sake of love? Are you ready and willing to step deeper into God's vast ocean of love? What do you hear the Good Shepherd saying to you? And what do you hear him saying to us as a church? Let's pray. Oh God, we are amazed by how you love us, and we cannot fully take it in, Lord, but we know it's true. Help us to hear your voice as you call us to follow you deeper into love. We want you to do your transforming work in us, that we might not just love a little, but rather live in love. Lord, we are willing to cooperate with your work in us, and so we give ourselves to you, trusting in your goodness. Amen. And affirm our faith.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was taken in. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Jesus Christ, our exalted Lord, has given all authority. Let us seek his intercession, that our prayers may be perfected by his word. Jesus Christ, great high priest, living forever to intercede for us, pray for the church and your broken body in the world. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, King of righteousness, enthroned at the right hand of the Majesty on high, pray for the world and make it subject to your gentle rule. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Son of Man, drawing humanity into the life of God, pray for your sisters and brothers in need, distress, or sorrow. Lord, hear us. Jesus Christ, pioneer of our salvation, bring us to glory through your death and resurrection. Surround your saints and angels with those who have died, trusting in your promises. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Lord over all things, ascended far above the heavens and filling the universe, pray for us who receive the gift you give for the works in your service. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, keep the church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at your feet. For you are alive and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, good morning. I have two announcements. One is that the catechesis of the Good Shepherd Level 3, ages 9 to 12, will be having a mini retreat on Saturday, May 1st, which is next Saturday, from 10 to 12, here in the church building, in the parish hall, and the atrium rooms. And it's going to be focused on the Eucharist. And they'll get to see some of the things that are used in the Eucharist. So it'll be a wonderful time. So if you have children, remember to bring them for that. And the other announcement is that if you have offerings, you may leave them in the box in the center aisle here on your way out. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
From the kingdom of God, the church.
yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was offered for us and has taken away the sin of the world, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, so that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as Christ our Savior has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people gathered around every altar of your church, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. You to come forward for communion. You can come down these aisles this way, and Father Ray and I will give you communion that you can take back to your seats and consume it at your seats. us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.